Bill.
My name is Mark Sorsea. I have my two kids trained. When someone says, your dad's a lawyer, isn't he? And they go, no, he's a prosecutor. So, you know, when I ran for prosecutor in 1996, I was worried that I might not be able to get elected because people might not be able to pronounce my name, Sorsea. And, you know, my mom's family's been in Putnam County since the 1790s. She married a guy from Brooklyn, New York that she met right after World War II, and that's how I got the ethnic name. And anyway, I had a friend that was out on a ridge somewhere and met a fella, and the guy came out and he said, well, I'm going to vote for that Mark Sorsucker because I think he'll be a good prosecuting attorney. So I felt really good. I thought, well, I can't pronounce it. Just vote for me. I married to my wife, Cynthia. She's a school teacher. She teaches second grade. I tell people she has a tougher job than I do. Dealing with second grade boys is a lot harder than dealing with murderers and bank robbers sometimes. She couldn't be here today because she didn't get out of class until after I had to leave. We have two children, Emma, who's 18, graduating from high school and looking at her college that she wants to go to, and my son Henry's 14, and he plays basketball and was beat by the Big Reds the last time we were here, but he's a good basketball player, and I'm very proud of both of my kids. I have been involved in public service for 20 to 21 years. I started as an attorney, got involved as an assistant prosecuting attorney, and I did some other work, brief stint in the Attorney General's office, and I was, you know, municipal attorney. In 1996, I decided to dedicate my professional career to public service, and I decided to run for prosecuting attorney in Putnam. I got elected, and I've been reelected three more times, so I'm in my fourth term as the prosecuting attorney of Putnam. I've been there, this is my 15th year. I decided to get involved in state politics and look at the governor's office in 2009, and I formed an exploratory committee in 2010. So I've been working on this for almost 13 months, 14 months. I sent an email to my friends. I said, I'm going to run for governor in January of 2010. And my friends said, well, Mark, you know, we think it's a great idea for you to get involved in state politics, but it's really kind of out of character for you. We're really kind of surprised because I was always thought of the professional law enforcement guy. I just loved being prosecuting attorney. I wanted to be the best prosecuting attorney I could be. And quite frankly, I think I got involved in politics because I needed to do that to get elected. As a prosecutor, I loved my job. I wanted to be the best prosecutor I could be. I got involved in national issues. I became a teacher. I taught other prosecutors trial skills. I was appointed to the Board of Regents of the National College of District Attorneys. And then I was elected vice president of the National District Attorneys Association, the national group. And in that position, I got to go to Washington and visit the Justice Department quite a bit. And I can tell you something. It really did me some good because I used to be frustrated about our state government, county and local government. But if you want to really get cheered up, you need to go to Washington because that is a whole new level of dysfunctionality. It makes me feel good about our state government because Washington is really screwed up. I decided to run for governor, quite frankly, because, ladies and gentlemen, I've lost faith in our Democratic political leadership in Charleston. I think what's motivated me to run for statewide office is the same reason that many people were motivated to get active in the Tea Party. I got mad. And I'll tell you exactly how I feel about it. I have the greatest respect for my Republican friends here that are in the legislature, and I'm talking about the Democratic leadership because I know these guys fight the battle every year, and I'm proud of them for what they do. But the Democratic leadership that's run our state for so long, I got the impression that almost under any situation, it always seems that their first instinct is always to do what's in their best political interest, or what's in the best political interest of their friends or their family or their financial supporters. It never seems to me that they're interested, their first instinct is to always do what's best for West Virginia first.
Amen.
This legislative session is a prime example. You know, the failures to address issues. And I know my Republican friends fought the fight. But it seems like the only thing they accomplished was giving pay raises. You know, I know a lot of judges. I tell people I feel like I'm getting old when I know all my lawyers' friends have become judges and all my state trooper friends have retired. And I know the judges say they don't make enough money. The family law judges definitely don't make enough money. I'd rather do a murder any day of the week than deal with a divorce. They're easier. And the magistrates feel like they needed money. And the teachers. But I don't know anyone in West Virginia that doesn't need money. Everyone's suffering. I had a friend, a 91-year-old friend, called me the other day, a lady that grew up with my mother, retired principal. She's get $500 or $600 a month in a retirement pension, another $500 a month in Social Security. Her food prices are going up. Inflation on food. American Electric Power is raising her power bill 10 to 15%. She told me she was worried about losing her daughter, her doctor, because of the Obamacare, with the doctor may not be doing Medicare anymore. She's paying $300 to $400 a month in prescription bills. How can we justify in state government giving out pay raises when our senior citizens on fixed incomes are suffering in this economy?
Yeah.
But you know, it goes back to the theoretical principle that it's always what is their first instinct is what is best for their own political agendas, and they gave pay raises out because they're dealing with the primary election in May. After 21 years of public service, I have learned one fundamental principle. Government by its nature is inefficient. The bigger it is, the worse it is. Go to Washington and we learn that. If I became your governor, I would be committed to the principle of reducing the size of our state government. The Democratic leadership in Charleston says, oh, we're in such great shape. We have a surplus. Look how great we're doing compared to the other states. But the auditor testified some time ago that between 2009 and 2010, they added almost 1,000 jobs to state government. State government in West Virginia continues to grow. If I was your governor, I would be committed to reducing the size of state government. As a prosecutor, I have been enforcing rules pretty much for the last 20 years in our society. And I would have a passion if I was the governor to eliminate needless government regulation and reporting requirements that's killing our small business community. Our small business community in West Virginia is dying a death of 1,000 cuts. There's always a bureaucrat in Charleston that wants our businesses to fill out a form. Oh, it'll only take them 30 minutes to fill it out. It takes you another 30 minutes to figure out how to do it. And then you fill it out, you send it in Charleston, they stick it in the file cabinet, and nobody ever reads it. Well, it only takes 30 minutes, but there's 1,000 of them. It's a death by 1,000 cuts. We have to get rid of government regulation. I'm a lawyer. Really, as my kids would say, I'm a prosecutor. I can tell you, if I became your governor, the first day I would be there, I would assemble a legal team and figure out a way to take our role in the national government to challenge Obamacare. I would join the 26 other states that are challenging Obamacare. Again, government by its nature is inefficient, and to deal with our health care issues in America, giving it to government is not the answer. What I bring to the table is a 20-year record of public service, of always doing what I thought was right. And I can tell you that if I'm lucky enough to be your next governor, my first instinct in any situation is always going to be to do what's best for West Virginia. And I am sorry. Thank you very much.